Hi, I'm Rob. Welcome to Math Antics. In this episode, we're going to talk about something that almost everyone likes. Money. Yes! Guess whose property that is?
But it's my last dollar.
Well, it's mine now. And just like all the other money.
And you have none.
Money, 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 money. Yeah. Some people like money a little too much. But what is money really? Is it metal coins or paper bills? Do IOUs count as money? Money is really just a representation of the value that we place on something. And we quantify that value using numbers. Ha! You knew this was going to turn into a math video at some point, didn't you? The way we quantify money in the United States is with a unit of value called the US dollar. If you have $1, you write it like this. This symbol that looks like the letter S with a vertical line through it is called the dollar sign. It's sometimes drawn with two lines, but that can look a little cluttered. The US government prints a paper bill to represent this amount of money. Not surprisingly, it's called a $1 bill. That's a portrait of George Washington there in the center. The $1 bill is an example of what's called paper currency. And currency is just a fancy word for the system of money used in a particular country. But you could have any number of dollars, couldn't you? 1, 2, 3, 4, 20. Is there a different paper bill for each amount you could have? Nope. That would get out of hand pretty quickly. The US government currently only prints bills for certain amounts, like 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 50, and 100. Although the $2 bill is rarely used by businesses nowadays, so we're just going to ignore it for this video. Sorry, Thomas Jefferson. These special amounts, called denominations, are like the building blocks of American currency. In written form, you can represent any amount of money simply by using numbers. $7, $19, $33, and so on. But when it comes to physical currency, you need to use different combinations of the bills that are available to represent all other amounts. For example, there isn't a $7 bill, but you could easily represent $7 using one $5 bill and two $1 bills, because 5 plus 2 equals 7. You could represent $19 using one $10 bill, one $5 bill, and four $1 bills, because 10 plus 5 plus 4 equals 19. And you could represent $33 using one $20 bill, one 10, and three ones, because 20 plus 10 plus 3 equals 33. Another important thing to realize is that there are usually different ways that you can represent the exact same amount. Take $20, for example. Hey, I didn't mean take my 20. You're gonna bring that back, right? Oh well. As I was saying, there are several different combinations of bills that you could use to represent the value $20. You could combine 20 $1 bills, since 20 times 1 equals 20. Or you could combine 4 $5 bills, since 4 times 5 equals 20. Or you could use 2 $10 bills, since 2 times 10 equals 20. Or, you could use just one $20 bill, thank you very much. As you can see, using 20 $1 bills is the least efficient way to make $20, while using just one $20 bill is the most efficient way because it uses the fewest number of bills. But if you want to make it look like you have more money than you really do, go for the 20 ones. On that note, can you think of the most efficient way to represent $49? It helps to break the amount you want to represent up into expanded form. 49 equals 40 plus 9. Since there isn't a $40 bill, the most efficient way you can represent $40 is using two 20s. And since there isn't a $9 bill, the most efficient way to get that, still ignoring the $2 bill, is by combining one 5 and four 1s. So adding up the values of all these paper bills gives you $49. Of course, there are a lot of other combinations of bills that you could use to make $49, but this is the most efficient way using the denominations that are commonly used. Are you starting to see how math and money work together? But you may have noticed that we've only been talking about amounts that are greater than or equal to $1. What about things that cost less than a dollar? Things that cost less than a dollar? There's no such thing. Everything costs hundreds of dollars these days. Well, that's a good point. There aren't very many things that you could buy for less than a dollar nowadays. But there's still a need to represent amounts smaller than a dollar. I guess that makes sense. Get it? Sense? Yes. Very clever. Don't spend all that at once. But I have to. I'm headed to the market to buy some magic beans. See ya. Oh, okay. Speaking of the market, that's a big reason that we need to be able to represent amounts that are less than a dollar. Can you imagine how crazy it would be if every time the price of a loaf of bread went up, it had to increase by a whole dollar? Fortunately, thanks to cents, it doesn't have to. What are cents? A cent, spelled C-E-N-T, is exactly 1/100th of a dollar. In other words, it's a fraction of a dollar. If you took the value of a dollar and divided it up into 100 equal parts, the value of each part would be 1 cent. And if you have 1 cent, you write it like this. Notice that the symbol for cents looks like the lowercase c with a vertical line through it. It's similar to the dollar sign we learned about earlier, but instead of writing it before a number, it's customary to write the cent sign after a number. Instead of using paper currency to represent the value of 1 cent, the US government uses a metal coin called a penny. That's a portrait of Abraham Lincoln there on the penny. And just like with paper money, the US government only makes a few different metal coins. They make a penny that represents 1 cent, a nickel that represents 5 cents, a dime that represents 10 cents, and a quarter that represents 25 cents. They also make a coin that has a value exactly equal to $1, often called a silver dollar, and one that's worth half a dollar. But those are mainly traded by coin collectors. Throughout history, many different coins have been made to represent different amounts of money. But since none of those coins are commonly used today, we're just going to focus on the four that are. And as mentioned, each represents a different fraction of a dollar. A penny represents 1/100th of a dollar. That means you'd need 100 pennies to equal the same value as $1. A nickel represents 5/100ths of a dollar, which is the same as 1/20th. That means you'd need 20 nickels to equal $1. A dime represents 10/100ths of a dollar, which is the same as 1/10th. So you'd only need 10 dimes to equal $1. And a quarter represents 25/100ths of a dollar, which is the same as 1/4th. Hence the name quarter, as in 1/4 of a dollar. That means that you'd only need 4 quarters to equal $1. Because these are the only 4 coins widely available today, you need to use various combinations of them to make other fractional amounts of a dollar. Like, if you wanted to represent 50 cents, which is half a dollar, since 50 is half of 100, you could do that in several different ways. You could make 50 cents using 50 pennies, but that's a lot of coins and wouldn't be very efficient. Instead, you could use 10 nickels because 10 times 5 equals 50. Using dimes would be even better because you only need 5 of them since 5 times 10 is also 50. But a much more efficient way to represent 50 cents would be to use just 2 quarters, since 2 times 25 equals 50. Of course, if you happen to have one of those fancy half dollars traded by coin collectors, just that one coin would have the value 50 cents. Here's another example. Suppose you want to represent 35 cents, which is 35/100ths of a dollar. Again, there are many different combinations of coins that would equal that amount. 35 pennies would do it, but again, that's the least efficient way. If you know your times table, you might realize that you can get 35 by multiplying 7 times 5. That means you can make 35 cents using 7 nickels, since each nickel equals 5 cents. An even better way to make 35 cents would be to combine 3 dimes to make 30, since 3 times 10 equals 30, and then just add 1 nickel to get 35. Or you could use the most efficient solution, which is to combine 1 quarter with 1 dime, since 25 plus 10 equals 35. The main point is that just like with paper currency, you can combine these 4 coins in a lot of different ways to end up with any number of cents that you need. Okay, so dollars are the basic unit of currency of the US, and cents are a way to represent fractions of a dollar. But how can we combine dollars and cents to work together to represent any amount of money? Good news, math has the answer. I knew math was smart like that. But not as smart as me for investing in these magic beans. Look how fast they're growing. Wow, that's pretty impressive. How much did those cost you? Just 99 cents. Well, of course, my water bill has gone up a lot this month, but Mr. Beanie McBean Tree is worth every penny. Bean Tree? Anyway, Our number system makes it really easy to combine dollars and cents using decimal numbers. For example, suppose you have $1 and 1 cent. You could write those as two separate amounts like this using the symbols we learned about earlier. But since you know that 1 cent is just a fraction of a dollar, 1/100th of a dollar to be exact, you can use decimal digits to combine them into a single dollar amount like this. Notice that in this representation, the dollar sign is still on the left, but the cent sign is gone. That's because this version represents money only in terms of dollars and fractions of dollars, which are represented using the two decimal digits. The first decimal place to the right represents tenths, which are multiples of the fraction 1/10. The second decimal place represents hundredths, which are multiples of the fraction 1/100. Do those fractions remind you of any of the coins we just learned about? Yep, a penny has a value exactly equal to 1/100th of a dollar. And a dime has a value exactly equal to 1/10th of a dollar. Since we have $1 and 1 cent, there's a 1 in the ones place representing $1. And there's a 1 in the hundredths place representing 1 cent. If we had $1 and 2 cents, there would be a 1 in the ones place and a 2 in the hundredths place. And here's $1 and 3 cents, and 4 cents, and 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 cents. But what if we had $1 and 10 cents? That would be $1 plus 1/10th of a dollar. So there'd be a 1 in the ones place, and a 1 in the tenths place, and a 0 in the hundredths place. $1.20 would be written like this, and $1.25 would be written like this. Can you think of the most efficient way to represent this amount of money using physical currency? Yep, you just use $1 bill plus 1 quarter for the 25 cents. But now, imagine what would happen to our decimal representation of this amount of money if we subtract the $1 and leave the quarter by itself. That would mean we'd need to replace the 1 in the ones place with a 0. Can you do that? Absolutely. Since a quarter is 25/100ths of a dollar, you can write it as $0.25. In fact, instead of using the cent sign, you can represent the values of all four coins in terms of fractions of a dollar like this. 1 penny equals $0.01. 1 nickel equals $0.05. 1 dime equals $0.10. And as we already learned, 1 quarter equals $0.25. Because of this handy feature of decimal numbers, the cent sign isn't used all that often. You'll almost always see cents written as fractions of dollars like this. But it's still customary to say cents when reading these amounts. For example, this amount is 12 99/100 dollars, or $12.99. But it would typically be read as $12.99. And this amount is 51 45/100 dollars, or $51.45. But it would typically be read as $51.45. All right, do you see how fractions and decimals help us work with money? They give us a way to combine dollars and cents into one system that can be used for any amount of money, big or small. And because money relies so much on place value, it's really important to understand how those concepts work. So if you found this video confusing, you may want to check out our videos about those topics before moving on. And doing math problems that involve money can be a great way to help learn decimal place value. So be sure to practice what you've learned in this video. Thanks for watching Math Antics, and I'll see you next time. I'll bet there's a whole lot of beans at the top of this tree. Learn more at mathantics.com.